All right, Donald, welcome to the lecture on 7.1. In 7.1, we're going to talk about how the different regional economies of the United States of America are beginning to create differences in the United States of America. What we want to look at now is how is the economic landscape of the United States changing, and how is that leading to more sectionalism in the U.S.? And we'll see between the North, the South, and the West, they begin to differ on how to move forward with these economic changes. The objective here is to understand the development of diverse regional economies, like I just mentioned, of the North, the South, and the West. And something to keep in mind is how do you unite such a diverse nation? And this is one of the challenges that the United States of America was facing at this time. Now, we've already talked about the American Revolution in 1776 to 1783. Now another revolution has hit the United States in the late 1790s, but more into the early 1800s, and that is the Industrial Revolution. Now the Industrial Revolution began in Great Britain. The United States of America was actually a bit behind Great Britain technologically at the outset, but eventually many of the ideas and the methods came over to the United States. Then the United States was able to take advantage of their vast amount of natural resources and be incredibly successful in their own right. Interchangeable parts and mass production are a huge part of the Industrial Revolution. Up to this point in world history, you would have skilled artisans creating a specific item, whether it is a cobbler creating a shoe or a carpenter building a chair. What you have is you have master craftsmen, people who are specifically skilled in one area, creating one item at a time. What happens here is it takes them a long time to create the item, and it's quite expensive. With the dawn of the factory age and industry in the United States, you had interchangeable parts. So you take a bunch of individual parts, you can put them together and create one object. On top of that, you can switch them out. So if one leg on the chair breaks, the chair isn't broken. You can just get another leg and put it into place. We deal with interchangeable parts every day in our society, but we don't really think about it because that's all we know. But up to this point, every single chair was unique. Every pair of shoes was unique. None were the same. What will happen with interchangeable parts is we will create a mass production. Soon, Americans will be wearing clothes that are small, medium, or large, not clothes that are specifically fit to every individual's body. This is a huge difference because what will happen is there will become more of a consumer society in the United States. More people will want to buy goods and more people will be able to afford goods because of it. The Industrial Revolution in the United States was helped out by the embargo of 1807 into the Non-Intercourse Acts of 1809 and, of course, the War of 1812. Now, we've talked in 6.4 about how damaging the War of 1812, the embargo and the Non-Intercourse Acts were on northern and even southern economy. Not trading with these powers in Europe really set the United States back quite a bit. It scarred Thomas Jefferson's presidential legacy, and it put the United States behind the eight ball economically. But one great thing it did is force the United States to look inward. Because we were no longer able to get European goods, we had to start an industry here in the U.S., and we see the beginnings of the Industrial Revolution begin to sprout up in the United States during this time period, because we had no other option but to look inward for domestic goods. What helped that Industrial Revolution take off is Samuel Slater. Now, at the time, let me give you a bit of a backstory before we get into Mr. Slater himself. At the time, England had all of this industry, but it was definitely illegal to take any types of plans or secrets from England to the United States to try and create some type of textile factory or any type of mechanized factory, any real industry that had already sprouted up in England. Samuel Slater actually memorized plans to a textile mill. He brought them to the United States, so he had no papers, no plans, no blueprint. He memorized it. And from scratch, he actually built the first textile mill in the United States. From there, the technology began to take off. So much so that in Lowell, Massachusetts, named for one of its founders, there was a factory that employed many teenage women and women in their early 20s to create full textiles. From this point, no longer are Americans wearing clothes, like I mentioned, that are fitted to them, but now they begin to wear shirts with a little bit of room in them because they're general sizes. But that makes it a lot cheaper for the consumer, and it allows the businessmen to make a lot more money because they're producing it cheaper and quicker. What's happening now, though, is that with this industry in the North, it begins to attempt to coexist with the agricultural society that has existed in the United States up to this point. Now, agriculture in the North, much smaller food-producing farms, self-sufficient farms. Because of this, they do not need an abundance of slaves. They're growing things like corn, which really takes very little manual labor. They don't need the slaves in the North, and they don't need slaves in the West because much of the soil is rocky in the West, and because we know the land ordinance in the Northwest Territory banned slavery anyway. So what we're beginning to see, by 1804, most northern states had actually outlawed slavery. This creates a huge sectional dilemma in the United States of America. The institution of slavery not only exists in the South, but is becoming even more important in the South. Whereas in the North, they're slowly getting rid of it because, well, they don't really need it. Once they begin to get rid of it in the North, then you begin to see a rising population of Northerners who speak out against slavery because of its moral ills and all of the problems that the institution represents socially. Like I mentioned, the South begins to rely even more on slavery, and they begin to rely more on slavery because of the invention of the cotton gin by Eli Whitney in 1793. Gin is short for engine, so basically it just means cotton machine. But what this did is this was able to remove the seeds from short staple cotton, which allowed cotton pickers to pick cotton at a significantly faster rate. What this does is this makes cotton farming more profitable. While one would think the invention of an engine that can do something quicker than people will make slaves less important, it actually, weirdly, had the exact opposite effect. Because cotton was now increasingly more profitable, southern plantation owners bought larger plots of land, and slavery began to spread all throughout the South, not just areas along the coast. Because of the great expansion of slavery and the huge profit that cotton was bringing the South, slavery became even more important to the South. What will happen is, as abolitionists begin to argue about the moral horrors of slavery, Southern slave owners will dig their heels in because they know without their slaves, their society would totally fall apart. Slavery becomes totally entrenched in the South, to the point where Southerners hang on to it as much as they can, so much so that in the next 40 years, this one-issue slavery will lead to a civil war in the United States. While the North and the South were definitely split over the slavery issue, the federal government was working hard to create a system that would bring the United States together. President James Monroe proposed such a system, and it was such a good idea that Henry Clay, the Speaker of the House, began to adopt it as his own, and he began to petition all the representatives in Congress to please vote for the American system. This system, dubbed the American system, had three main tenets to it. They wanted to establish a tariff, resurrect the national bank, the second bank of the United States, and create internal improvements to make transportation and communication much easier in the U.S. to bring the United States together. They're trying to carry on or ride this wave of nationalism following the War of 1812, which ended in early 1815. And now that the U.S. feels united and feels nationalistic pride, the government wants to build on that. They want to increase industry, bring money together and bring the people together. Now, how do you increase industry? You pass a tariff. No longer do we have an embargo act, but the federal government recognized if we pass a tariff which raises the prices on foreign goods, that will make our goods in America more competitive. So just to throw out generic examples, if a chair in America costs $5, but the same chair from Europe costs $4, Americans are more likely to buy the chair from Europe. But if you put a $1.10 tariff on every chair, now American chairs cost $5 and European chairs cost $5.10. While that doesn't make a lot of merchants happy, what it does is it increases production in the United States of America because now everyone is buying American chairs. So more chair factories pop up, more workers are employed, and this increases technology, the spread of ideas and industry. So by raising the prices on European goods, you're indirectly encouraging growth in the United States. The National Bank was created. The first National Bank, as we know, was created by Alexander Hamilton under George Washington's presidency. But when the small government Jefferson became president, he basically depleted the National Bank, really limiting its effectiveness. And then the law which created the first National Bank ran out. So they needed to create another one. This did not really create any type of sectional conflict because everyone loved the idea of a common currency. It makes it easier for trade, it makes it easier for business. I should go back to mention this tariff definitely was opposed by the South and the West because they didn't have industry, they didn't have factories. So by raising the tariff on European goods, you're not promoting any type of industry in the South or industry in the West. All you're doing is making goods more expensive, which means Europe is making less money, which means they have less money to then buy cash crops or goods from the South and the West. So this was seen as a tariff that really benefited the North primarily more than any other region. And I'm sure you can understand why. Lastly, internal improvements. A national road was built from Cumberland, Maryland to Vandalia, Illinois. The Erie Canal, 300-plus mile canal, connected the Great Lakes with the Hudson River, which then connected them to the Atlantic Ocean, saving huge amounts of time on trade. What this will also do is this will connect trade between the East Coast and the Northwest Territory, because now you can travel up the Hudson through the Erie Canal to the Great Lakes and down into Ohio, Indiana, Western Pennsylvania, etc. This American system really helped connect the United States of America. But what we can see here in 7.1 is a clear divide forming between the North, the South, and the West. And what it is a divide that will continue to build up and build up, especially as we begin to expand westward. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask your history teacher. Thanks for watching.